Hello students, welcome to the course Lasers Fundamentals and Applications. In today's lecture, we will study the measurement of laser power, energy, wavelength and frequency and how the line width will be measured, right? So let us study the measurement of power and energy. So what is the need of measurement, right? So the most fundamental method for checking the performance of a laser is to measure its power or energy output. Laser output directly affects a laser's ability to perform a process, right? Measuring and monitoring this parameter is often very important from the time a laser is first manufactured through system integration and on to the final end customer who will be using the laser system in applications as far ranging as medical, scientific, biomedical and industrial applications. Since there are many different types of lasers with widely varying specifications, there are different measurement technologies available that are appropriate for specific types of lasers and match to particular laser specification. Let us study the various components of the measuring system. First one is the sensor. First is a sensor that is placed into the laser beam and provides a signal output proportional to the laser input. Then we have a meter. The second component is the meter, which is an analysis and display instrument that will interpret the signal from the sensor, apply various analog and digital corrections, compensating for the difference between the calibration wavelength and the wavelength of the laser, and then provide a measurement. So this is a typical, we can say, the instrument used in the measurement of laser power, right? So laser beam will be inserted on the sensor, the sensor will detect it and the meter will measure and it will display, right? So we have to measure power and energy. So right, the power of a laser is referring to the optical power output of the laser beam, which is continuous power output of continuous wave lasers, or the average power of a pulse or modulated laser. So we have continuous laser, we have pulse laser. So for continuous laser, it is a continuous power output, and for pulse laser, it is average power output of the laser, right? It is measured in watt, and for most often in terms of nanowatt or milliwatt or watt, etc. units. The energy of a laser typically refers to the output of a pulse laser and is related to the power output. When the energy E is the laser's peak power, P peak multiplied by laser pulse duration, right? So energy E is equal to peak power into the pulse duration, right, T. So P peak into T is gives us energy. The average power of a pulse laser, P average, is the pulse energy E multiplied by the laser repetition rate in hertz. So average power is equal to E into energy into the frequency in hertz, right? So for example, an excimer laser might have a 10 nanosecond pulse width, hence energy of 10 millijoules per pulse, and operates at a repetition rate of 10 pulses per second. This laser has a peak power of P peak is equal to 10 millijoule per 10 nanosecond, which is equal to 1 milliwatt. And average power is equal to P average is equal to 10 millijoule into 10 into 1 cycles per second, which is equal to 100 milliwatt, right? So the pulse length can be very short, that is picosecond or femtoseconds, resulting in very high peak powers with relatively low pulse energy, or can be very long, that is milliseconds, resulting in low peak power and high pulse energy. While each of these conditions might have similar average power levels, right? So what are different sensors used to measure laser power and energy? The most common measurement technologies are pyroelectric sensors that can only measure pulse lasers, thermopiles that can measure pulse or continuous lasers, and semiconductor photodiodes, commonly referred to as optical sensors, that are sometimes restricted to continuous only lasers and can sometimes be used with both pulse and continuous wave lasers, depending upon the intended use. So there are different types of the sensors used. So pyroelectric sensor, they are used to measure the energy of pulse lasers and can only work with pulse lasers. Average power is calculated by measuring laser repetition rate and multiplying by the pulse energy. In case of thermopile sensors, measures continuous lasers, continuous wave lasers, and integrates energy of pulse lasers to produce an average power measurement. Can also be used to integrate the energy of a single pulse. Most common for measuring energy of millisecond or long pulse width, medical and industrial lasers. And we have another technology, that is semiconductor photodiode or optical type of measurement. So most often used in measuring low continuous wave laser powers, right? Also used in some sensors for measuring low pulse energy, however may not respond to continuous wave lasers when used in this way, right? So now let us move to how the measurement of wavelength and frequency is done, right? For the measurement of wavelength, we have this diffraction grating kind of arrangement. When the laser beam is incident on this diffraction grating, so we know the diffraction grating, it has very fine lines carved on this glass plate by using a diamond, right? So very the lines very small, we can say lines are placed at very short distances, and when the laser beam is incident on it, a diffraction pattern can be seen on the screen, right? So we will get a central beam, we call it principal maxima, and on the both sides of this principal maxima, what we have, the secondary beams, right? So this is, so we have the principal maxima at the center, then on both sides we have the laser beams. So this is, we call it first order diffraction pattern. So this is first order, this is first order, right? Then on the beyond the first order, we have the second order diffraction pattern. So this is second order, this is second order, and this central part is called as principal maxima, right? So if lambda is the wavelength and nu is the frequency and c is the velocity of light, then this lambda is equal to c upon nu, that relation we know, right? Measurement of wavelength can be done by using this experiment, right? So the Bragg's diffraction condition is d sin theta is equal to n lambda, where n is the order of diffraction. The wavelength is then given by lambda is equal to d sin theta upon n, right? And therefore, if you place the diffraction grating here in between laser and screen, then laser beam will pass through this diffraction grating, it will give us pattern on the screen, right? So by measuring the distances between this, we can say the diffraction grating and screen, and between the principal maxima and first order diffraction pattern and second order diffraction pattern, one can easily determine the angle theta, and from that one can easily determine the wavelength of laser. So this is, in this way, the measurement of wavelength can be done, and from from wavelength one can easily determine the frequency of the laser. Let us study how the measurement of laser line width can be done. So what is mean by line width of a laser? So line width of the laser is defined as the frequency difference corresponding to the intensity equal to one half of I, that is maximum intensity. It is also known as the full width at half maximum, or FWHM, right? So this is typical line shape of the laser. So in this line shape, if we Imax is the maximum intensity, at half value of the maximum intensity, if we measure the width of this bell-shaped curve, that will give us the line width delta nu, which is also called as full width at half maximum, right? A laser line width can be measured with a variety of techniques. For large line widths, traditional techniques of optical spectrum analysis, for example based on diffraction grating, are suitable, right? Another technique is to convert frequency fluctuations to intensity fluctuations using a frequency discriminator, which can for example be an unbalanced interferometer. For single frequency lasers, the self heterodyne technique is often used, which involves recording a bit note between the laser output and a frequency shifted and delayed version of it, right? Very high resolutions can be obtained by recording a bit note between two independent lasers, where either the reference laser has significantly lower noise than the device under test, or both lasers have similar performance, right? Let us study the self-heterodyne line width measurement. One frequency use method for measuring laser spectral line width is the self-heterodyne bit method. In this method, we have a self-heterodyne line width measurement setup. So, in this method, a signal is passed through a fiber Mach Zehnder interferometer, right? So, this is the fiber Mach Zehnder interferometer. The laser will be beam will be passed here at the splitter. We will have two parts of the beam, right? So, the beam will be splitted into two parts. One part will go to this arm, right? So, and another one will go this towards this arm straight, right? So, this is acoustic optical modulator or AOM frequency shifter, right? So, light from two arms interfere at the receiver. So, light coming from this arm, so it is fiber delay line. So, it will take longer time in this fiber network. So, again that will be come back to this we can say detector, right? So, polarization controller will be there. So, these two beams they will interfere at this detector, right? So, one portion of the laser beam is sent through a long optical fiber which provides some time delay, while another portion be sent through an AOM which shifts all the optical frequency component by some tens of megahertz. Both beams are finally superimposed on a beam splitter, and the resulting bit node centered at the AOM frequency is recorded with a photo detector, right? So, photo detector will detect both the compare both the signals rays coming from these two, right? So, this typically it has length is typically in few kilometers, right? So, integration of phase noise. So, an alternating way to determine or define the line width would be to use the root mean square RMS value of the instantaneous optical frequency, right? So, delta nu RMS is equal to square root of integration from f1 to f2 s delta nu of f into df, where usually some limited integration range for the noise frequencies is chosen, right? So, range of noise frequencies from f1 to f2 is chosen. This quantity can be easily calculated from the power spectral density. So, s delta nu of f is called as power spectral density of the instantaneous frequency, right? So, these are two methods we have seen for the measurement of frequency. So, in summary, we have seen the how the measurement of power, energy, wavelength and frequency of the laser can be done, and how the line width measurement can be done, right? So, thank you very much.